यस्यान्तर्नादिमध्यं न हि करचरणं नामगोत्रन्न सूत्रं नो जातिर्नैव वर्णं न भवति पुरुषो नो न पुंसो न च स्त्री नाकारो निर्विकारो न जनन मरणं नास्ति पुण्यं न पापं नो तत्त्वं तत्त्वमेकं सहज समरसं सद्गुरुं तन्नमामि चिन्मयो नाम रूपस्य आनन्दो वै स्वभावतः वेदगीता समुद्धर्ता ज्ञानयज्ञव्रते स्थितः चिन्मयौ जीवनौ यस्य स्मरणौ यस्य चेतना ज्ञानदानौ धृतिर्यस्य तस्य पादौ भजाम्यहम् समस्तजनकल्याणे निरतं करुणामयं नमामि चिन्मयं देवं सद्गुरुं ब्रह्मविद्वरम्। अजमपि जनयोगं प्रापदैश्वर्ययोगात् अगति च गतिमत्तां प्रापदेकं ह्यनेकं विविधविषयधर्मग्राहिमुग्धेक्षणानां प्रणतभयविहन्तृब्रह्म यत्तन्नतोऽस्मि अतीतः पन्थानम् तव च महिमा वाङ् मनसयोरतद्व्यावृत्यायं चकितमविधत्ते श्रुतिरपि सकस्य स्तोतव्यः कतिविधगुणः कस्य विषयः पदे त्वर्वाचीने पतति न मनः कस्य न वचः। Now we are on the fifth query and we will chant all the seven verses, seven mantras of this fifth query. Atha panchama prashnaha atha hainam shaibhyaha satyakama paprachha सयो हवै तत् भगवन्मनुष्येषु रायणान्तमोङ्कारम् अभिद्यायीत कथमं वावसः तेन लोकं जयतीति तस्मै स होवाच एतद्वै सत्यकाम परञ्चापरं च ब्रह्म यदोङ्कारः तस्माद् विद्वानेते नैव आयतने नैकतरमन्वेति स यद्येकमात्रमभिद्याजीत स तेनैव संवेदितस्तूर्णमेव जगत्यामभिसम्पद्यते तं रुचो मनुष्यलोकम् उपनयन्ते स तत्र तपसा ब्रह्मचर्येण श्रद्धया सम्पन्नो महिमानमनुभवति अथ यदि द्विमात्रेण मनसि सम्पद्यते सोऽन्तरिक्षं यजुर्भिः उन्नीयते सोमलोकं स सोमलोके विभूतिम् अनुभूय पुनरावर्तते यः पुनरेतं त्रिमात्रेण ओमित्येतैनैवाक्षरेण परं पुरुषमभिध्यायीत स तेजसी सूर्ये सम्पन्नः यथा पादोदरस्वचा विनिर्मुच्यते एवं हवैः स पाप्मना विनिर्मुक्तस्य सामभिः उन्नीयते ब्रह्मलोकम् स एतस्माज्जीवघनात् परात्परं पुरुषयं पुरुषमीक्षते तदेतौ श्लोकौ भवतः तिस्रो मात्रा मृत्युमत्तः प्रयुक्ताः अन्योन्यसक्ता अनविप्रयुक्तः क्रियासु बाह्याभ्यन्तरमध्यमासु सम्यक् प्रयुक्तासु न कम्पते ज्ञः ऋग्भिरेतं यजुर्भिरन्तरिक्षं ससामभिर्यत्तत्कवयो वेदयन्ते तमोङ्कारेणैवायतनेनान्वेति विद्वान्यत्तच्छान्तमजरम् अमृतमभयं परं चेति इति पञ्चमः प्रश्नः। We started somewhere in July 2015, 1-5, and we are at the close of the last but one question. And there is one more balance, which is the, you can say, the crest and crown of the whole query. So now we have covered the main aspects of Upasana. There are two aspects. First one is the Upasana, which everyone has to start with, because it is contributing to the mental purity and concentration, where one merges his mind with the deity that is being worshipped. So for tuning the mind to the required purity and concentration, the Upasana is always recommended. Without this kind of cooperation from the mind, that is, mind tuned up to the required purity and concentration, it is not possible for the intellect to undertake Vedantic contemplation. Meditation is the word used for Upasana. Contemplation is the word used for deeper meditation. So, in order that the intellect should conduct the Vedantic contemplation, the mind has to be fully prepared, equipped in terms of purity and concentration. So then together, it is exploring with a world which is obvious and beyond. Upasana has a limitation by which the seeker reaches the world of the total mind and remains there. So if the Upasaka goes up to this, then he goes by the path of gradual liberation. There he remains with the total mind, and the total mind is already flared up into the creation. So unless that creation is dissolved, there is no scope for this Upasaka to be liberated. The tenure of a given Brahmaji has to be over. Then along with the Brahmaji, this Upasaka also will get liberated. The Vedantic contemplation is in continuation with this. So those Upasaks, those seekers who are striving hard even further. So this was only a result of meditating upon A, U and M that the Upasaka has reached the total mind. Now here the Kavayaha Vedayante is in between Putin. The wise people have understood the heart of the technique and they have taken up AUM together and meditating upon that. They got the clue in M, as the word, the matra is ending in silence. So this sound ending in silence is the clue that is indicative. From what is obvious or manifest to indicate the unmanifest, the consciousness which is silence, this is the state. And the wise man capitalizes on that. Then he also gets all these three, as the Upasak has already got those three, Bhurloka, Bhuvarloka, Swarloka, etc., reaching Hiranyagarbha. But he goes beyond as well. So the statement there in the book was, he gains all these and go beyond. Is the actual statement. In this is that the wise man, he kavayaha vedayante, the wise one reaches these. When you say these, this is the fifth para, last statement. The wise one reaches these. These means all the three lokas as well goes through, and also that which is beyond. So he goes through Bhurloka, Bhuvarloka, Swarloka. He gains all these incidentally. But the speciality of this effort is that he goes beyond these three lokas and reaches Maharloka. This is a great gain. So the first lap of the evolution, or here the progress of the seeker, is to go beyond these three lokas. The Swamiji has used the word beyond twice. The second one, when he uses, sometimes he uses beyond the beyond. The second beyond is indicated by this term, beyond the beyond. So there are two levels to be crossed or transcended. The first level is transcended when all the three lokas are transcended and one enters into Maharloka. Maharloka is the area of total intelligence where there is an effulgence of consciousness. And here then, as described already, that he gets all his sins cleared and thus he has become sinless, and the sinless one is led by the Samaveda Devata to the realm that is next to that. So this, we have seen this first level of our first lap of progress as reaching the three lokas and going beyond. This is the first level. The second level is Vedantic contemplation. On this level, the seeker picks up from the Maharloka, which is the blaze of consciousness. From there, he smells the higher possibilities and reaches Janoloka. We have discussed up to this, I believe. And the first indication of that is that he experiences endless bliss. This endless bliss is the indication as the pure consciousness whose nature is bliss. So Chidananda is the state in which the ananda is experienced as the nature of knowledge. So So this is up to this we have seen, and the later higher lokas, he reaches the last one, the Satya Loka, and beyond this is considered as beyond the beyond. So when he transcends all the lokas, the experience is called transcendental. Transcendental is lokatita, alaukika. Laukika is the experience gained in all the seven lokas. It is called laukika. That which is beyond these lokas is alaukika. And that is the last word in the Vedantic contemplation. So this mainly we have seen these two levels of beyond. First level is transcending for the lower three lokas and going into the Maharloka, the connecting loka. And the next is when he reaches Satya Loka and transcends that, he gets the transcendental reality. Now this we discussed objectively with reference to lokas, but as such, all these things happen within ourselves. This is a progress of the seeker within himself. There is nothing outside ourselves. Everything is within ourselves. Therefore, we need to consider this at the individual level as well. So this was easy to grasp. In a sense, it is objectively described, going to this loka, that loka, etc. But these lokas are terraced within the individual. The first three lokas, Bhur Loka, is related with the gross body. Gross body is a form made out of the tamasic aspect of all five great elements. So this is Bhur Loka. The one who contemplates on A, he understands the essence of all forms, not only his body, but all forms in the world is five great elements. And to that extent, he is able to reach the total, sum total of all gross bodies put together, called as Virat. And likewise, the next to the Annamaya Kosha is Pranamaya Kosha. Or contemplation on you aspect leads him to Pranamaya Kosha. Actually, this is the place from where the jiva has sucked in the required prana force to fulfill his prarabdha, to experience his prarabdha, and has entered into Bhur Loka. So this Pranamaya Kosha, here there is a sense of ego associated with Manomaya Kosha, the mind. The mind and the prana, the association tickles the mind with a flow of thoughts, and prana reflected in this flow of thought is otherwise called as ego. The I, the ego, is reflected in the pool of thoughts in the mind. Therefore, Pranamaya and Manomaya Koshas are associated in as much as the prana force activates all these equipments, and so the mind. And when mind is activated, it is full of thoughts, with lots of thoughts. And the in these thoughts or pool of thoughts, the prana force is reflected as ego. We have these discussions in the early portions of this Prashnopanishad. I'm not telling anything new. So this sense of ego has prana force behind. So long as the prana is bubbling within, the ego will always tend to raise its head or hood. So this is the this is correlating with our Pranamaya Kosha, where it is called as Soma Loka, It is also called as Pitruloka, and it is also called as Bhuvarloka. Bhuvarloka is only full of pranas connecting Bhurloka and Swarloka. Among the lower three, this is the middle one, and it connects both the three, higher and the lower. So the jiva, after his given life is over, he is thereafter guided according to his merits and demerits to higher loka, swarga loka, or again back to mrityu loka. So that we have seen that kshine punye mrtya lokam vishanti. This is all controlled by the bhuvar loka, where the jiva should be led according to what is at his credit, whether the meritorious acts or the sinful act. Accordingly, he will be led to the lower world or the higher world. So thus the jiva is shuttling between Bhurloka and Swarloka and again back to Bhurloka. So this is what we are trying to correlate: the Annamaya Kosha, Pranamaya Kosha, and Manomaya Kosha up to this. When we transcend these three, then we entered into the intellect or Vijnanamaya Kosha, in which there is a shine of intelligence. And this shine of intelligence is the, is we can say, as the part of the total intelligence in Maharloka there. So Maharloka and the intelligence in our intellect, they are connected by this sadhana. So attempt in meditation or Vedantic contemplation is that the individual first should be able to be aware of the totality. So from the individual body, the upasana reaches him to the totality of the body, is called as Virat. Similarly, individual pranamaya kosha should able to lead him to the Bhuvarloka. The total, all the egos are located there in this pranamaya kosha, or the, at the high level, the total Bhuvarloka. Identification with the mental sheath, manomaya kosha, through upasana, it goes to identify with the total mind, and he reaches the realm of Hiranyagarbha. This is all the upasana or sadhana that enables the individual through meditation becomes aware of the totality, so that then he merges with the totality, understand that he is only the part of the whole, and he merges with the whole. So the upasana takes him from individual level to the total level. At the physical, then vital air, then mental, then intellectual. When he transcends the mind, and then his attention is hooked up to the intelligence in the intellect. This is something great. This is something called as beyond the three lokas, Maharloka. To go to the intellect and become conscious of the thoughts and ideas therein is something normal. We are those who are thinking, they are aware of the thoughts and ideas in their intellect. But while thinking the thoughts, Swamiji has referred in the next paragraph, that is the para 7, the starting point he has suggested, to see the post, one has to see through and through the ghost. So at the intellectual level, we have intelligence, and intelligence is superimposed by thought. The light is now appearing as illuminated thought. So now if I am concentrated and concerned with the thought itself, my attention is not there with the intelligence. I get stuck up with the thought. And there are variety of thoughts, good thoughts, bad thoughts, indifferent thoughts, the thoughts that I am concerned with, the thoughts that are disturbing me. He gets involved and caught up in the web of thoughts. But here the idea suggested is that if you want to see the post, see through and through the ghost only. So here the thought is like a ghost. It is delusory nothing. Thought is mithya. We have already discussed this earlier, that thought is nothing but the consciousness and avidya coming together gives rise to something, a third thing called as thought. Now if you see thought, yeah, and this we have already seen it, discussed it earlier, like flower and the thread, and the garland as the resultant one. The garland is mithya. Similarly, the thought is mithya because there is a mithya avidya and the consciousness behind that. They have given rise to this thought. So now while contemplating upon the thought of the self, this is Vedantic contemplation. The upasana is over the moment it has reached the total mind. But the wise people, kavayaha vedayante, the wise people collectively meditate upon Om, A, U and M collectively, pronounced as Om. They collectively meditate on this Om and they reach all these three lokas and beyond. So when they reach beyond, when they will be able to reach the beyond, when the thought in the intellect, they will continue to contemplate upon that. And so that they should not get caught up in the web of thought, they have chosen the thought of the self for contemplation. The thought of the self, though it is not the self, but definitely it is in harmony with the self and will not make us go away from our point of concentration. So the thought of the self, while contemplating upon the thought of the self, our attention should go to this fact that I am conscious of the thought of the self that is being contemplated upon the mind. Mind is the tool for contemplation or meditation, either way, both sides. Mind is the tool, and now the mind is asked to contemplate upon the nature of the self. While I am observing this, that the contemplation upon the nature of the self is going on, I am conscious of the thought of the self. Thought of the self is taken up by the mind for contemplation. And I am conscious of the thought. Then a question should come to me, how I become conscious of the thought unless the thought is illumined? So this thought of the cause for the illuminated thought as illumination is the one which takes me beyond. So thought is not beyond, but the thought of the self, when I am conscious of, it gives me, I become aware that the very fact that I am conscious of the thought of the self itself means this thought is illumined, without which I will not be conscious of. So when the thought is illumined, which is the factor that illumines the thought? Definitely, I don't illumine the thought. I am only observing the contemplative effort made by the mind. But the very fact that I am conscious of all this itself means that this whole thing is illumined. And to go in for the light that illumines the thought. Now compare, equate the parallels. To see the post, you have to see through and through the ghost. That was the suggestion. So to see the light, we have to see through and through the thought. The thought is the ghost or mithya. And the consciousness, the light, is satyam. Now to reach that satyam, how can we come across directly the pure consciousness? It is not possible. Mr. Ego cannot survive if I have to experience the consciousness. I cannot go as an egoistic individual and meet the consciousness or self. Therefore, ego has to be surrendered. Now, this ego is not immediately cannot become consciousness, but he becomes conscious of consciousness, meaning he becomes conscious of the light that illumines the thought of the self, etc. So this shift of attention from the thought to the light that illumines the thought. Now, all that comes in our mind and intellect, all thoughts, feelings, perceptions, etc., are illumined by the conditioned consciousness called as Chidabhas. So it is the Chidabhas which illumines my inner world of thoughts and ideas and emotions and all that. Therefore, my immediate attention should be shifted from the thought of the self to the light that illumines the thought. Therefore, for the first time, I become conscious of consciousness, the light of consciousness. Now, this consciousness is definitely the reflected one, the reflection. But then I have reached the link between body, mind, intellect on this side, Bhurloka, Bhurloka, Swarloka on this side, the intelligence in the intellect in the middle, and which has its source in the pure consciousness. Then it links me to the higher three lokas of Ananda, Chit, and Sat. So Ananda is the first one that I have to come across when the intelligence is reached and transcended. So the reflection is reached and transcended. The first experience of this is the experience of joy, unalloyed joy or bliss. Unalloyed in a sense, this joy is not caused by anything. Ordinarily, my happiness and sorrow is caused. If I am happy, there is a reason for it. If I am sorrowful, there is a reason for it. But if I am blissful, there is no reason, because bliss is the very nature of knowledge, and knowledge is my true nature. The individual jiva's true nature is pure knowledge, whose nature is bliss or ananda. Therefore, seeing through and through the thought, I reach the light that illumines the thought. The moment I reach the light, I have reached the link between the lower three lokas, body, mind, intellect, and the higher three lokas, Ananda, Chit, and Sat, in a graded manner. So first I will experience the pure bliss, endless bliss, as a result of this effort. Vedantic contemplation. So this is the first level where I reach the link which will connect this lower three and higher three. Now this link will help me go beyond. or connect to the higher lokas. At this level, we have seen in this paragraph, the same seventh paragraph, that when I have reached the level of intelligence, then through contemplative effort, I will reach the level of total intelligence. And this total intelligence or Mahaloka has a full control over the lower three lokas. And therefore, the description we have got in the seventh para is that the here it is said that represent by its silent samatra. Here, seventh paragraph, the same first starting statement, only a long sentence. To see the post, one has to see through and through the ghost. In this sense, it is said here that those who have realized the Om completely as represented by its silent amatra aspect gain a mastery and freedom. This is the one. Mastery and freedom, a kingship and control, proprietorship and power over the world of the mortals. The world of the mortals is Bhurloka, Bhuvarloka and Swarloka. So one who has reached the level of intelligence in the intellect has a full control over body, mind and intellect at the individual level, and by this continuous contemplation, when he becomes one with the total intelligence, he becomes as good as the Lord Krishna, who is in the Mahaloka, who has a perfect control over the lower world. He has already indicated that in Gita also. If you see the seventh chapter, there it is said, the 13th, Tribhir Gunamayair Bhavaihi Ebhis Sarvamidam Jagat Mohitam Nabhijanati Mamebhya Param Avyayam. I am Param, the Supreme, and Avyayam, the Immutable, and I am beyond these three gunas. Three gunas represented respectively by Bhurloka Tamas, Bhuvarloka Rajas, and Swarloka Sattva. These are the three lokas represented by three gunas, and I am beyond these, and I control all these, definitely. So here the Lord himself says, so Tribhir Gunamayair Bhavaihi Ebhis Sarvamidam Jagat Mohitam Nabhijanati. The deluded fool will never understand this. He won't know me, he won't know either who is controlling what. But Nabhijanati Mam, he will not understand me. How am I? Param Avyayam. So this is indicated in that seventh chapter where he introduces his lower prakriti and higher prakriti. So the lower prakriti is the lower three lokas. Higher prakriti is the higher three lokas. And he is a connecting link between the higher three and the lower three. Then one who is at that level, he fully controls the lower three lokas. That is the most important thing. So all the lower three lokas goes by laws and regulations. There is a perfect administration of this Almighty, the Lord. And thus, that is what we have seen here in the seventh paragraph, that he gets full control, etc. So now it is said here. Now see, how is the description? The same level, third sentence, the knower of Om, apart from the above, also becomes consciousness itself. And as such, it is not only these that he gains, but that which is beyond. The second time the word beyond has come in the seventh paragraph. So this is much just a little below the half of the para. The knower of Om, apart from the above, also becomes consciousness itself. This is his gain. From the reflected consciousness as intelligence in the intellect, he goes to the source as pure consciousness and becomes pure consciousness. The seeker becomes pure consciousness and beyond. As such, beyond consciousness is nothing but Brahman, the absolute. And he reaches that. Therefore, the Brahman is called as beyond the beyond. The first beyond is when he transcends three lokas and lands in the Maharloka, or intelligence in the intellect. And the next transcendence is he becomes consciousness and goes beyond. So consciousness being the inherent power of Brahman, therefore going beyond that is to become Brahman. And this is suggested that he not only becomes consciousness itself, and as such it is not only these that he gains, but that which is beyond. When you give a gold a necklace, this is an example given. Now Swamiji is talking to the public at large in his Yajneshala. Therefore, it is not possible for him to explain the deeper significances. So instead of explaining the deeper significance of what is consciousness and beyond, he simply tells that when I give my sister a necklace, I give the gold as well. So gold is the material cause of ornament. And see, we have discussed this several times. Ornament is nothing but the gold itself plus name and form. Now this, we are well acquainted with this equation. Now this is the method, Vedantic method of Adhyaropa and Apavada. You say something which is not really true, you start with falsity, and then you negate the falsity and say it is wrong. Now here, how is the falsity? When you say ornament is equal to gold plus name and form, name we keep aside, but form, you have already split the form separated from the ornament or gold. Do you mean to say gold has no form? Gold has form. But what you said, ornament is equal to gold plus form. Now here it is called Adhyaropa. We have already said that form is something other than the gold. And now you are saying, when I give you ornament, I have already given you gold. Now you are making it as one. Earlier you have separated it as gold plus form is equal to ornament. Therefore, gold minus ornament minus form is equal to gold. But this is a bluff. But what to do now? You have accepted ornament as real. Therefore, then you have to say that ornament is nothing but the gold with a particular form. The form is perishable, but the gold is not perishable. That being the very material cause. And this is given here by the illustration that when I give my sister a necklace, I have given him the gold also. Now see the difference. I don't know whether the general public or listeners will appreciate this, but they will understand that ornament is gold only. Gold ornament, not golden ornament. So golden ornament is a different case. But gold ornament, when you say, we have in mind, we are aware what we are purchasing. We see the ornament is a fancy of mind. Today you want this type of design and that type of design or change of ornament and all that. But finally you are weighing gold only, basically. You are conscious that you are buying the gold in the form of ornament. So this kind of thing is the Vedantic way of explaining you. And Acharya has to say that Adhyaropapavadabhyam Nishprapancha Prapanchate. Actually, there is no prapancha at all. But we have to say there is prapancha And then we have to say that the prapancha is only appearance of the form, which is perishable. And what is important is the contents of that. So the contents of that being consciousness. The consciousness itself has become name and form of the world, which is called as prapancha. Prapancha means it is a play or game of five great elements, pancha. Five great elements, when they come mix up among themselves, they end in the different forms. And all these forms put together is what we call it as the world. So the world of names and forms is in reality nothing but consciousness itself. But to say that, they first accept there are forms, and then they say how the forms are created, and they go to the root cause of material cause and the intelligent cause or efficient cause. So this intelligent or efficient cause is consciousness, which goes into it, and this illumines it, and the material cause is the existence itself. So existence and consciousness together is responsible for the world of names and forms. So here we are in the closing comment of this paragraph. The illustration of necklace and the gold is given, and it is only means that there is no difference between gold and ornaments. So as such, even the world of names and forms is nothing but Brahman. This is the statement. So when I am talking about the world of names and forms, I am talking in your own language, but as such, it is not names and forms, but names and forms is only appearance like ghost, and you have to see through and through ghost to see the post. Similarly, here also, you have to see through the form and the names through and through, and see that behind the form, there is a content of the form. The content of every form is consciousness. This one has to understand. So this involves a Vedantic contemplation. And here, to become consciousness and go beyond is to become the efficient cause, and finally becomes Brahman, the very material cause. So this aspect is indicated in the seventh paragraph. Now we are at the eighth para. We have read last time also. Now here it is, Swamiji is talking about, he is directly commenting on the last line. So we have in between discussed in details about Yat Kavayo Vedayante. We have discussed in between and bridged the gap between the lower three and the higher three. And Swamiji has already said to go beyond consciousness by indicating the term Vidvan, Yat, Tat, Shantam, Ajaram, Amrutam, Abhayam, Paramcha, Eti. The Vidvan goes or reaches there. What is that? He reaches the quiet, then undecaying, Ajaram, then deathless, Amaram, then fearless, Abhayam, and then supreme, the Param. So this is directly Swamiji has started his commentary on this last line, and that is starting from 8th para onwards. This is the greatest definition of truth. Now, I think last time I have read this paragraph, this and the following, but it only says that the important statement, the 8th paragraph only indicates to us that when the Rishi has reached that experience where he has become consciousness and gone beyond the beyond, to describe this experience to his students who are on the other side, meaning who are in the first three worlds, and they want to know. Now the first three worlds are haunted by the sense of fear of death, fear of all changes, etc. Therefore, the teacher in Prashna Upanishad is describing his experience in terms of the language that is understandable to the student. The student doesn't know what is fearlessness. They know what is fear. If their whole life is fearful, and we have last time discussed how right from the birth onwards the fear is accompanying us. And every now and then when there is some suddenly jerk or impact or something, then the fellow gets scared. So this kind of fear is there right from our birth onwards. And the birth gives rise to different modifications, the changes. Therefore, this ajaram is the, what you can say, miserable state, the birth, the growth, and further the modification where some diseases, etc. start. But later on, apakshiyate means it is the sense of decaying. This one is scared again. So decaying, one knows that this old age is something which is, we have to go through that, all the problems due to old age, all the suffering due to old age, all the limitations due to old age. Our all powers are waning. And with all this, nobody wants to suffer the decaying or old age pains. So here it is indicated that they are all conscious about the decaying aspect in the process of change. Change started from existence. The jiva exists, is born, is growing, then is modifying, then is decaying, and then he dies. So this is the process of change. These are the different modifications that the physical body undergoes, in which so long as it is growing, etc., is okay. But once it starts decaying, then these are the problematic areas one has to go through. So this is first the reality that is reached by the master is being described as ajaram, undecaying. You won't have any sense of decay when you reach that realm of experience where you have become consciousness and crossed beyond. You will be free from any sense of decay. This reminds me of Kathopanishad, where the Kathopanishad describes the heaven also, swarga. So this heaven is described where those jivas who are enjoying the heavenly bliss, they never grow old there. That is the one of the indications. They are ever young. They never grow old. They are free from the diseases and this kind of thing. So when this is seen, then we can understand that this is the language that can be understandable for the mortal who thinks that he is born and he is going to die. So the first thing is undecaying, and that is indicated as ajaram. Jara is the old age. And that old age is a decaying stage where all the energies, powers, etc. are waning. So this is said. Then next one is amrutam. Amrutam is opposite to mritam or mortality. So mortality, we are all aware. Everyone is born, has to die. This is what everyone is aware of. And therefore, the master is explaining or describing his experience in terms of the language known to the student. And that is that all of us are mortals. So one day or the other, we have to leave this world and our bodies will fall down. So those who think I'm the body, they think that they are going to die. So for this kind of people, or the seekers, students, the master explains his experience in terms of immortality. There is no fear of death. There is no fear of decay or decaying or old age. So you land in the area of experience wherein there is no fear of decay, there is no fear of death. These are the two. And then the very fact, the fear which is accompanying us right from our birth, fear of old age, fear of death, but the fear is common. And this fear instinct is, the feeling of fear is going on, going, starting from the birth onwards, where we have seen last time how a child gets scared the moment it is born and it cries. So from this onward, the fear is there. And to explain his experiences, the master says in terms of fear that it is abhayam. Abhayam is fearless. The experience is where there is no sense of fear at all. So this is abhayam. So basically, ajaram, amrutam and abhayam, these are the three main things which the ordinary seeker is aware of. What he is aware of is that the person is subject to old age, which is painful. The person is subject to death, which nobody wants to die. And the person is all through insecure with fear. So this he is aware. So in terms of his known weaknesses, it is said by the master that the experience that he has reached is something which is free from all these defects or limitations, free from the decay or old age is ajaram, free from the fear of death is amaram, and free from the fear of all such changes in life is called as abhayam. So these are, there is no fear. These are basically the three things which Swamiji calls it as express negatively. So there is a technique of explaining your experience negatively, and this is indicated in 8th paragraph. So the definition, it is said here that the wise one comes to experience that which is undecaying, deathless and fearless and supreme. So supreme is something the highest, the great. And one who is at present is not aware of his supremacy of the self. Instead, what he is aware that he is a mortal jiva and he is subject to different changes. He is born and he is bound to die, etc. He has lowered himself or underestimated himself from the standpoint of body. And to such a person, this description in terms of the fear, the undecaying and deathless and fearless is really apt. But the supreme is also included in it. Therefore, we wonder how we can apply it to the seeker's life, which he doesn't feel that my life is supreme. He feels that my life is full of limitations and he suffers those limitations. Limitations in terms of mortality, in terms of sorrows, in terms of ignorance, and so many other limitations. So it is free from all that. Is indicated that it is the supreme wherein none of these weaknesses reach there, the supreme state. But otherwise, what I thought was that the first one, which is described as shantam, see, there are five words used: shantam, ajaram, amrutam, abhayam, and param. So shantam and param are something which is where there is no comparison. And in between, the ajaram, amrutam, abhayam are something which are negatively expressed. The absence of all those defects that seeker is scared of, they are not there in the final experience. So these in between three are definitely the expression of master's experience in terms of seeker's understanding, and therefore it is called negative, negatively expressed, that it is not the sense of decaying, therefore undecaying, not the sense of dying, therefore it is a sense of immortality, free from mortality, and lastly it is free from a sense of insecurity and fear. So these middle three are the expressions that can be said to be negative, because that is the language that the seeker can understand. And the first one and the last one is something which one needs to reach there and experience. For instance, the first one is shantam. And shantam is the very characteristic of consciousness. When you have become consciousness, one has become shantam. So shantam is the characteristic of consciousness. So in consciousness, there is no disturbance, no sound. It is silence. And this silence is indicative by the silence that follows the M matra of Om. So AUM is all disturbance, and M lands in silence, and that silence is the support or substratum and the basis support for all the sounds that are created. Therefore, from the silence, the sound rises. Due to silence, the sound is supported, substrated, and unto the silence, the sound merges. So this is the process in which when Om is fully chanted with all its the deep meditation, Swamiji has described that, deep and long meditations on Om as collectively chanted, completely chanted, so that it ends in silence. The wise man is, his attention is there, goes to the silence aspect. So from sound, he lands into the silence and he becomes silent. So to become silence is to become consciousness. And this the beyond the silence is something not describable, but moment he reaches the silence, he has as well reached the abode of truth. So this is the idea which is indicated in the 8th paragraph. In the 9th paragraph, he has given a little details of that. So the 9th paragraph tells us the important statement made here in the 9th paragraph is the starting one, second sentence. From the finite, the infinite can only be pointed out. From the infinite, the finite cannot even be pointed out. This statement is important. So from the finite standpoint, you can indicate the infinite. But once having reached the infinite, there is no finite at all to indicate. This is very important. And therefore, the language, negative language used is, because at present the seeker is experiences the finitude of his existence with mortality, etc. And for him, in the same state, he can be his attention can be drawn to the something which is beyond his limitations. So free from the birth, death, and all the fear, etc., is something that can be indicated to the student who is going through the finitude, suffering from the finite. So from the finite, the infinite can be indicated. But once you have reached consciousness, the silence, there is no finitude at all to be pointed out. In silence or in consciousness, there is no disturbance at all. The first disturbance in the silence is the thought. When thought itself is missing, then all further gross manifestation of thoughts into the sounds and the activities, etc., are all missing. And therefore, from the standpoint of infinite, finite cannot be indicated or talked about, because there is no finite at all. But it is for our good that when we are going through the experiences and suffering the finitude, for us, the teacher points out to something which is infinite. It is possible from the standpoint of finite to indicate the infinite. But it is not possible once you have reached the infinite, there is no finite at all. Finite is not able to reach the infinite. This has to be appreciated. And that's what this, I consider this ninth para, this particular statement is most important statement. Then Swamiji has commented in the same paragraph that they have to talk to us about it in our language of delusion. The language of delusion is what the at present we are all using. It is a language of delusion because we have accepted the body as the self, and all related to the body is the world of names and forms. We have accepted the world as real, body as the self, world as real, and therefore it is whole, it is due to the delusion. First delusion is that I am the mind. Mind itself is delusory, nothing. But when I consider the mind, the language of delusion starts. Then the mind, later on, I identify with the body also and say, I am the body. Earlier I said, I am the mind. And mind itself is delusory, nothing. In a sense, if you start searching for what is mind, it will disappear. Therefore, that is itself is a delusion. And I go further and identify with the physical body, say I am the body, and that is the greatest delusion, which makes us feel that the outer world is real and the world as such is apparent. We have already seen in our discussions of Sat and Asat. Therefore, this is the language of delusion. So this is what Swamiji is describing here boldly, that they have to talk to us about it in our language of delusion. So in our delusory existence, we generally experience five great modifications during our life: the birth, growth, decay, disease, and death. So these are the detailing out of the eighth paragraph. So in terms of all these five and the consequent fears, the printing is tears, it should be read as tears. So although there are twice it has appeared as tears, we can correct it to fears, because abhayam or bhayam is the concern. So this these are the five. An ordinary mortal life is a round of these agonizing fates and the consequent fears, not tears. Waking through the violence of ignorance, we slip at every step on the rocky surface made specially slippery with the fears of those who have walked over them before us. So this is what we are following. We see that the elders have already gone dead and gone, and we have to walk the same path. This is a slippery, because the jiva does not die. Jiva is immortal. Jiva is Brahman only. And when jiva starts feeling that already my elders have gone, dead and gone, I am also going by the same path. This is called as the, so here it is said that it is a rocky surface made specially slippery with fears of those who have walked over them before us. So this kind of description is all the world of change is, we are the victims of the world of change. and the last measurable change seems to be the death. And the person has already seen that his earlier generation, he has seen they are dead and gone, and therefore he has also to walk that. This is all happening in the bylane of ignorance. It's only possible in the bylane. When you come to the main road, all these things are not possible. So all bylanes of life, jivas are caught up at this moment. They have to come out in the open and try to understand beyond this sense of limitation that there is something. And the masters are trying to indicate to us with the help of finite, they try to indicate the infinite and say that that is your true nature. So this kind of expression of their experience in negative language is one content. And what is the present condition of jiva? That he is affected by the ignorance, a bylane, and there in the bylane he has got the rocks which are slippery, and he has already seen that his earlier generation has already gone through and gone, therefore he is also subject to death, etc. So this kind of experience the jiva is having. And then we come to the important statement. This being the common, this is a concluding statement of the para. This being the common experience of every thinking seeker, the rishis have to explain the infinite, the goal of life, to their disciples as a plane of existence wherein they will not have any of these sorrows. The sorrows due to the birth, the sorrows due to the modifications, sorrows due to the decay and death. All this will not be there. This is assured by the masters. So their experience explained in terms of ajaram, amrutam and abhayam, they are just opposite to what the jiva is already acquainted with. So this is how it will go to their head, or they will be able to understand, conceive something, the kind of experience that the master has gone and is describing. So this is the 9th paragraph. We are coming to the 10th one. We find here terms that negate our today's experiences. And this negative language at best can only indicate the experiences in the beyond. The term undecaying only means that the experience of constant decay, which is a part and parcel of our life now, will not be our lord there. So this is again, the today's experiences are negated. Here, this is the negative language about that he is commenting. And we are already acquainted with the negative experiences, and the experiences of the master are something contrary to this. So this is about undecaying. This is a special comment on ajaram. Then on amrutam, the 11th paragraph talks about that. Deathless is the term said to suggest that the mortality that we are suffering here, not only in our physical structure, but also in our outer world conditioned by the finite concepts of time and space, is again not there in the infinite. So the experience of the infinite is without this. What is this? The physical structure is subject to change. That is what is explained here, the mortality. And also the world, outer world of objects in their different setups keep on changing in time and space. So time and space are the basis of the outer world, and they keep on changing. This kind of change is not there in the final experience, and therefore this is said as deathless or immortal. So death is a principle of change. Death does not mean the last word. Death is indicative of the principle of change. Right from birth onwards, every moment there is a change. If you see outside, the early dawn is born and the night is dead. The morning is born and the dawn is dead. And likewise, this birth and death is only a change in the present condition. So that is indicated by the term death. And the experience of the infinite is something beyond death, meaning it is not subject to change. It is a changeless, continuous experience of the infinite. So infinite has no limitations, and therefore it is, in other words, it is called a limitlessness, limitless experience. So this is the 11th para, which comments on Amrutam. And lastly, the 12th paragraph is commenting on Abhayam. So fear is the bugbear which seems to have been born with us, and it remains with us all along so faithfully that it is doubtful whether even on the deathbed we can really get divorced from it, the fear. And it is the fear complex that taxes us the maximum and punishes us the most with largest doses of sorrows and failures in life. The infinite, being the one without a second, cannot have fear, and so it is indicated here as fearless. Now here is a speciality, Abhayam or Nirbhayam. So this speciality is that we have already earlier seen that he becomes consciousness and goes beyond. Now the one that is beyond is here indicated by the term Abhayam. So this Abhayam, how is it? That beyond consciousness and consciousness, see the difference. The consciousness and the world is, you can say, a pair. Consciousness and the objects of consciousness. That is the world of names and forms, including our body, mind, intellect, etc. Objects, emotions, thoughts, all are included. So this is the world. The consciousness and the world, this is the pair. When one becomes consciousness, in consciousness, there are no objects, no emotions, no thoughts. It is free from all sense of change, free from the sense of birth and death, etc. So this is already, we have already seen. But here it is described specially as one without a second. Now, with consciousness and the world of OET, we can say that consciousness is one and the world of OET are many. So one and the many, this is the couple. At the lower level, within us, there is a world of objects, emotions and thoughts. There is our equipment of body, mind and intellect. And there is an individual called as the perceiver, feeler, thinker, I. Now, all these are many. Among this lot of the many, there is only one consciousness which illumines them all. So the consciousness is one, and rest all are many, right? So the objects of consciousness are many. The consciousness is only one. So one and many is the couple, is the pair. Whereas beyond consciousness, it is one without a second. There is no second. For the consciousness, there is a world of names and forms, the second. But beyond consciousness, when it comes to the absolute, it is described here as one without a second. Check up this, the 12th para, the infinite, last statement, the infinite being, the one without a second, cannot have fear. So infinite is indicative of consciousness. And what is beyond consciousness is not different from consciousness. We have seen it several times. The outer world is not different than the body. Body is not different than the mind, like that. So the consciousness is not different from that peace which lasts in that existence. So the final existence, which is called as absolute existence, which is therefore called as one without a second, the consciousness is not different from that. So with reference to the world of OET, BMI, PFT, the consciousness is one. With reference to the absolute, consciousness itself is one without a second. See the reference, consciousness is common. On the one side, there are many. With reference to many, consciousness is one, the one. But with reference to something beyond consciousness, which is called absolute, it is called as one without a second. So the consciousness is one with many, and the absolute is one without a second. So the one without a second is otherwise called as Brahman. So Brahman or the truth is called the absolute, and absolute is described as one without a second. And one without a second, we have a technical term, ekam evam advitiyam. Ekam eva advitiyam brahma. So these terms, ekam evam advitiyam, is telling us that the Brahman is free from any kind of differences. Difference is bheda. A true knowledge is that which indicates that truth which is free from any kind of difference. Bheda. Abheda darshanam jnanam. The true knowledge is that which indicates to us something which is one without a second. There is no difference. Now this aspect is indicated here. Swamiji has just indicated this last one. So here we have to see that the truth, ultimate truth, is called the absolute, and it is called the absolute because it is free from any kind of differences. The type of differences that we have are the sajatiya, the differences among the same species, then vijatiya, the differences among different species, and swagata means the difference within oneself, a given thing. So swagata, sajatiya, and vijatiya. When we say ekam, it is indicative of sajatiya. It belongs, there is no sajatiya difference. It is ekam, only one. Now when it say evam, means in that sajatiyam, there is no swagata difference also. So it is neither sajatiya difference nor swagata difference, indicated respectively by ekam and evam. And advitiyam indicates that there is no vijatiya difference as well. There is nothing else involved. So absolute is that which is the one without a second. And in that, the one alone, when we say that there is no kind of difference either due to the same species or due to the given species within itself. No kind of difference is admitted here. So this ekam evam advitiyam is indicated here, one without a second. Now this is indicative of absolute, and next to that absolute is the one infinite consciousness. So we can say the eternal truth and the infinite consciousness. These are the two levels. One who has become consciousness has reached or attained the infinite reality. And one who has gone beyond this infinite reality has become the absolute, the truth, which is one without a second. And this is indicated in the last. Now the main question was, what happens to the seeker who worships Om as a symbol of that reality? What are the field of experiences that he goes through, etc.? So here the fifth query in answer is describing the various levels that reached by the seeker. Then we have seen that in two phases. The first one is reaching the Swarloka, remaining with Brahmaji till the dissolution of the universe, and through gradual liberation reach the ultimate. This is one. Second is to reach that and go beyond, is to reach the intelligence in the intellect. This is the second level. And then the Vedantic contemplation will take you even beyond this Marloka and gives you the first-hand experience of the endless joy or bliss, which is indicative of Janoloka. And then proceeding further, you become consciousness itself. So this is indicated by Tapoloka, which is full of pure consciousness. And so the experience of I am pure consciousness is available next to bliss. And lastly, the Satyalokam gives one the experience of the truth, which is indicative. It is an experience, therefore it is not the last word. The Brahman is not experienceable, but I am Brahman. This is experienceable. Aham Brahma is experienceable, but the Brahmanhood as such is beyond our experience. So this I am Brahman is experienced in the last loka, Satyaloka, and there he completes the evolution through all these lokas, and going beyond this is reaching the absolute. So it is called Lokatita, Alaukika. We have earlier referred, it is called transcendental. Lokatita is transcendental. So that truth, ultimate truth, is beyond the beyond. First beyond is related to the Chidananda, infinite consciousness bliss. Then he becomes consciousness itself, and goes second beyond the consciousness, that is Brahman or the truth. So thus we have how a seeker can go to different realms of experiences by worshipping Om. And that was the question, the fifth query. And then various levels of progress that are reached by the seeker has been the whole concern of the fifth chapter, fifth query, and we are at the close of this. Now, the last paragraph says, if there is thus an undecaying, deathless, and fearless state of existence, our intellect may still ask us whether, after all, that factor is in itself the supreme. Chances are that we may still wonder at the possible existence of something yet higher, a truth that produces this infinite, in order to show that the eternal, fearless Brahman is uncaused and yet is the cause for the total world of plurality. The Rishi advises us that it is the Supreme. So this is commentary on Param. So the last one, that it is Supreme. So once we have become consciousness, as such, there is nothing beyond. The consciousness itself, when the last stages of contemplation, when I experience that I am the pure consciousness and remain steady at this experience, then I become aware of something which is next to consciousness, which is part and parcel, of which the consciousness is part and parcel, and that is absolute truth, which is again not the next state. Moment you have reached the consciousness, you have as well reached the ultimate truth. And this is the subtle level of meditative state, wherein having studied as I am the consciousness I, one becomes aware of the next one, and there he realizes that consciousness is only the power which is inherent in the Brahman. So to become aware of that, while you are already rooted in the experience of consciousness I, is here indicated by the term Param, the Supreme. There is nothing higher than that. Because the intellect can, because it's a logical, there is no end to that kind of logic. What is higher than that? When having reached, what is higher than that? That is reached. So likewise, one's intellect may question like this, whether there is anything higher. And we will, here it is clear that this is the last word. Moment you have become pure consciousness, which is all pervasive, illuminating the entire creation, then you don't have to go anywhere. You have to remain steady in that experience of consciousness I, and in that steady state of meditation, you will become spontaneously aware of the root of consciousness, or the basis of consciousness, as the absolute, or the absolute existence. So existence is the last word, and we can smell the possibility of becoming that the moment we have become pure consciousness. This is indicated here in the last paragraph. And with this, the fifth query is over, unless you have questions. If you can put in your questions on the WhatsApp group and put the summary of what we have discussed, then it will be helpful to me, so that I will not repeat again, and I'll proceed to the next one. So as far as today's discussion is concerned, the fifth query is over, and unless we have questions, we will proceed to the last query about this conscious being, or the consciousness is the power of consciousness that belongs to the Purusha, the being, and what is the nature of that conscious being. We'll discuss that in the last one. This is the culminating topic, the best question among the lot. In all the six questions, this is the final question, and it is therefore a very interesting question. So now, Shobha has raised the hand. Yes.
Sir, in this Shantam, Ajaram, Amrutam, Abhayam, and Param, these are the levels. Now Shantam in Shantam and it has taken its first, and then Param is last. So Shantam and Param, that what like Paramashanti and Shanti. So is it that Shanti can become Ashanti, and that is why the opposite that have taken first as Shantam, because Param is also a Paramashanta.
So the Shantam is referred to consciousness. Consciousness is silence. Now the consciousness as silence, and beyond consciousness, the Param. In fact, that consciousness is the supreme, is suggested later. Then what is the difference between consciousness, the silence, and consciousness, the Param?
Yes.
There is a difference. Yes. The difference is only that the consciousness has a reference to the world, illuminated world of OET. Whereas when it is said Param, the consciousness is free from any sense of object. So the object part of it, when it is with the consciousness, it is only called as Shantam. And when the consciousness has totally been withdrawn from any objects to be witnessed, or when all the objects of witness are ended, then the consciousness is without any objects. And that consciousness without object is called objectless awareness. And this objectless awareness is the supreme. Whereas one step below, it is consciousness with the objects to be conscious of. So consciousness is common denominator. Whereas it has objects to be conscious of, it is called Shantam. Consciousness is always silence and is able to illumine all the world of disturbance, emotions, thoughts, etc. But itself is Shantam. But when even this reference of the objects of consciousness is removed, meaning negated, I have nothing to do. I am a witness of the presence as well as the absence of thought. Okay, in short. Now, how does it matter whether the thought is present or absent? It has not affected my existence. I am the consciousness. I am conscious of thought, their presence as well as absence. Therefore, I negate the thought. I am not interested whether they are present or absent. I alone am. Therefore, when he becomes the objectless consciousness, it is called as the supreme awareness. So the awareness is supreme, Param, and the consciousness with objects is called as Shantam. That's the only difference.
Sir, ek question ahe.
Bola.
When a seeker establishes in consciousness, then it is described as Abhayam, Amrutam, Ajaram, etc. But physical body is still with him. And he is going to die sometime here and there. Then how he carries that feeling of Amaram?
I see, you are only contradicting yourself. When he said he has become the pure consciousness, he does not die. The consciousness is not subject to death. Now, when you identify yourself with the body and say, I am the body, then of course the body is subject to death. So, dehe jate, aham jataha. This is the identification, mistake of identification. How it goes? Dehe jate, aham jata. In the birth of the body, I am born. In the growth of the body, dehe pushte, aham pushtaha. In the growth of the body, I am growing. Then in the death of the body, I die. This is a mistake of identification. And one who has identified himself with consciousness, where is the question of mortality? He is aware that the body is subject to death. And he is not the body. He is consciousness. So he is aware of the fate of body-mind or the ego. And therefore, he only oversees that. Only he witnesses what is going on. but he himself is not involved in it, nor he is affected by the states that the body is going through. Therefore, either you identify with body and suffer, identify with consciousness and become free from all the sense of limitation. Choice is yours. अरे जो चंचलासी भजेल तो सहजची चढ़ेल, जो निश्चलासी भजेल तो निश्चलची. So there are only two things here. The one is changing and another is changeless. So if you identify with changeless, you become changeless. And if you identify with changing, then all the mortality, sorrow, everything belong will come to you, to your account. Instead of BMI, it will go to your account as Mr. Ego. The egoistic individual will go through all the suffering. So we conclude now with our prayers. Yasya prasadadahameva Vishnuh, mayeva sarvam parikalpitancha, ittham vijanami sadatmarupam, तस्यांग्रि पद्मं प्रणतोऽस्मि नित्यं, तस्यांग्रि पद्मं प्रणतोऽस्मि नित्यं. ॐ श्री चिन्मय सद्गुरवे नमः. हरि ओम.